I call your attention to the book of Acts. That's Acts, the 20th chapter. And we're going to read verses 29 through 32. Acts, the 20th chapter. Verses 29 through 32. And I'll be reading from the New King James Version. That's Acts, the 20th chapter. Verses 29 through 32. And we will find these words. For I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. Also from among yourselves, men will rise up, speaking perverse things, to draw away the disciples after themselves. Therefore, watch and remember that for 3 years I did not cease to warn everyone night and day with tears. So now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. Amen. Paul's parting counsel to the church. Paul's parting counsel to the church is the subject that we're going to talk about this morning. Paul's parting counsel to the church. Paul's parting counsel to the church. If there ever lived a man in the first century AD who communicated the Christian idea to a world filled with hate, barbarism, inhumanity, ungodliness, that man is Paul. If there ever lived a man who could either start a riot or a revival, that man is Paul. If there ever lived a man who could speak fluently many languages and preach in Athens as easy as he could in Jerusalem, that man is Paul. The Apostle Paul is considered a prince of the church and one of the greatest apostles in the New Testament. In fact, he wrote many of the books of the New Testament. He was the great interpreter of Christianity and a bold, unapologetic evangelist. It was Paul who developed the meaning of the church in ecclesiastical language. It was Paul who created the Christocentric theology of the church, which makes Christ the beginning and the center and the end of man's salvation. The Western world owes a great deal of appreciation to Paul, who sold the word of God in this part of the world. Paul traveled many miles to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Ever since his conversion on the dusty road to Damascus, Paul never turned back. He was a man on a mission, a man who was serious about his calling regardless of the perils he had to endure. Paul suffered much for the gospel of Jesus Christ. 3 times he was beaten with rods. Once he was stoned. 3 times he was shipwrecked. Once he had to spend a whole day in the open sea. He was jailed, bitten by a snake, and went through all the trouble, trials, and tribulation of being an ambassador for Jesus Christ. The more Paul suffered, the more he preached the gospel. The more opposition against him the more determined he was to spread the good news of the kingdom of God. The more he was jailed, the more epistles he wrote to the Christian church. Are you praying with me? You see, Paul says, woe is me if I preach not the gospel. Come hell or high water, Paul was compelled to preach. He was compelled to write in order to instruct, to challenge, to inspire, and to encourage the Christian churches in the faith. Paul is a shining example of what we ought to be doing in our postmodern times. Now, those of us who are called by God to preach the gospel doesn't have the luxury of preaching for popularity. We don't have the luxury for preaching for recognition or preaching to be inducted into the hall of fame. Preaching is not about impressing the hearer. It is not an oratorical contest or who can best wax eloquently behind the pulpit. God chose the foolishness of preaching to save those who believe. Did you hear what I said? So Paul shows us that preaching is about salvation, about reconciliation, and the redemption of a sick and torn world. Paul didn't preach to tickle the ears of the people. He didn't preach to give false hope and unrealistic expectations. Paul preached to save people in order to usher their souls out of the kingdom of this world into the kingdom of God. Now we must do the same in our times. You see, we have to preach and teach the truth whether people want to hear it or not. Whether it makes them happy or whether it makes them mad. You see, we are not called to sacrifice the truth on the altar of materialism. We are not called to trim the truth to be politically correct. I wish I had somebody here. Make you free. Not the Constitution of the United States. Not the Bill of Rights. But Jesus says the truth shall make you free. You hear what I said? So we are called to preach the gospel in season and preach it out of season. We are called to comfort the afflicted and then to afflict the comfortable. My brothers and sisters, we must come to that the kingdom of God is too precious to miss. The journey is too thrilling not to take. And souls are too ripe for the harvest to play around with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We always talk about speaking truth to power, but we also must speak truth to the powerless as well. That same gospel that gets the poor into the kingdom of God, it's also the same gospel that gets the rich into the kingdom of God. God has no respect of person. And it's God's will that all men, that all women, and that all people come to repentance. Did you hear what I said? My brothers and sisters, it did not matter to Paul about race. It did not matter about creed, color, or socioeconomic class people were in. The gospel of Christ must be preached to all people because it is the power of God unto salvation. As I said to you before, that I didn't come to First Baptist to preach a potato chip gospel or give you ice cream grace, because that would create spiritual constipation. And you know how you feel when you get constipated. Jesus Christ. He preached in many towns and villages and halls of learning. He taught from house to house. and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, he spent a considerable time with the people of Ephesus. He taught them the word of God. He instructed them in the principles of God and freed the Ephesians from their narrow-mindedness, to free them from their idolatry and their spiritual ignorance. Paul declared unto them the whole counsel of God. Yet he knew that upon his departure, there would be savage wolves waiting to move in and devour the flock. He told the elders of Ephesus, he called them together and said, now, my departure is near, and you are the leaders of the church, which Christ purchased with his blood. Upon my departure, there will be people coming in sheep clothing, but they are savage wolves. They are men who will come and pounce upon you with their heresy. They will be smooth-talking rhetoricians who will use their philosophical concepts, their Jewish fables, their cunning myths, and their unprofitable genealogies to lead the church away from the truth. Jesus Christ. And these vain doctrines of teacher will not let up unless they're strong leaders. Let me repeat that, unless they're a strong leader to protect the church from diabolical doctrines taught by hypocritical imposters. Did you hear what I said? So Paul was warning the leaders of the church not to allow themselves to be duped by unscrupulous, to watch out for the Judaizers, who only believe in the Mosaic law and not in Jesus Christ. He warned them against Gnosticism, the doctrine that claims creation was formed from a lesser deity, and that the material realm is evil and ought to be escaped. In other words, Paul was saying to the leaders at Ephesus, walk not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the seat of the scoundrel. Watch out for the wolves outside of the church who want to move in and destroy the church. Not only watch from the outside, but I want you to watch from on the inside. Because there are wolves in the church who are waiting for an opportunity to pervert the gospel of Jesus. From external enemies, if it nurtured no foes within his own bosom. Paul says to the elders, for 3 years, I've been wanting you to watch not only from without, but watch from within. Yes. The enemy loves to join the church in order to destroy the church. Yes. After Paul gave his departing counsel to the church of Ephesus, he told them, now I commend you to God and to his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among those who are sanctified. So Paul tells the church, I commend you to God, not to some man, not to some political party, not to the most famous family in the church, but I commend you to God, who is able to keep you, who is able to sustain you. His word is able to fill you up so that you can stand against the savage bulls who will move in and not spare the flock. No matter what you have to face, no matter what storms you have to endure, no matter situation you're in, I command you to God, who is able to keep you from falling, and present your faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding the joy. I commend you to God, whose word is like a hammer that can break the rock in pieces. For 15 years now. And I'm getting ready to go on a sabbatical. I don't want you to let your guards down like the children of Israel did in the wilderness and end up building a golden calf. Watch and pray, because the enemy of the church is crafty and cunning. The enemy of the church is waiting to turn hearts and minds away from the truth.
Because while the past is away, the demons are here. Gonna try to move in. But if I had some demons that will uphold the bloodstain, if I had a pride that will uphold the stain, if I had some trustees, if I had some leaders in the church, some followers in the church, they'll hold up the bloodstain back. Against us. I'm gonna leave you some good hands, some sure hands, some everlasting hands. Yeah. The door of the church is open. I leave you first, in good hands, in God's hands, everlasting hands, miracle working hands, because He's able to keep you from falling.